Good morning and welcome to this, the first meeting of 2022, and the first meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee. We are obviously operating in a hybrid format this morning with members participating remotely. And before we start, I have the pleasure in welcoming a new member to the committee in Ruth Maguire. Not just to the committee, but back to Parliament. And we're all delighted to have Ruth back with us at Holyrood. Before I ask Ruth to declare her interests, such as they may be, can I also thank and pay tribute to Bill Kidd. We veterans must stick together. And I've been working with Bill over many years during the time that I've been a member of the Parliament, and very much valued his contribution, sound judgment and advice during the months that he has served with us on this committee. I know he'll be serving Parliament in some other capacity, and I wish him well in so doing. But thank him very much for the job that he did with us over the last year. So the first item on our agenda this morning is in fact to welcome Ruth Maguire, and just for Ruth to establish for the record whether there are any interests that she would wish to declare. Ruth.
Thank you for the welcome, convener. I'm looking forward to the work ahead on the committee. I have no registrable interest to declare.
Thank you. The second item on our agenda today is the consideration of continued petitions. And the first of those is petition number 1723, Essential Tremor Treatment in Scotland. This was lodged by Mary Ramsey and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to raise awareness of essential tremor and to support the introduction and use of focused ultrasound scanner for treating people in Scotland who have this condition. I'm delighted to welcome back Rhoda Grant, MSP, to the committee to speak to this petition. And before I come to Rhoda, I'll provide a little more background. When it was last considered in September last year, the committee agreed to write to the University of Dundee to seek an update on the MRG FUS system, an ultrasound scanner system. A response from the University of Dundee has now been received and has confirmed that their focused ultrasound system has been used to treat 5 patients with essential tremor. A funding approval has been obtained from the individual NHS health boards for patients to be treated in Dundee over coming months. Now, the committee also wrote to the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport requesting an update on plans to submit a proposal to the National Specialist Services Committee to allow this to become a standard form of care. And applications to the committee have now been halted due to the pandemic. At present, the majority of those wishing to access this treatment are forced to travel long distances to access care in England. Rhoda Grant, welcome back to, I mean, I do tease sometimes that you're with us more than I think some of our committee members, but it's a pleasure to have you with us again this morning. And is there anything you would like to further update the committee in relation to this petition?
Yes, and thank you, convener. And I think it just shows how important the committee is to my constituents that I seem to be here a lot of the time, because it makes a real difference to people's lives. And I hope with this petition, it can have that impact as well. And since the committee last considered the petition, I've obviously spoken and met with Mary Ramsey virtually on a number of occasions. And following some of those meetings, obviously with Mary herself and other stakeholders who have an interest, I wrote to Ralph Roberts, the chair of the National Specialist Services Committee. And he told me that the National Services Division is due to meet with the clinical team in Dundee towards the end of this month to discuss how a formal application for designation and the relevant paperwork can be prepared for consideration by both the National Patient, Public and Professional Reference Group, as well as the National Specialist Services Committee. And they told me that the next scheduled meetings of these groups are scheduled for February and March, but it's unlikely that they'll discuss focused ultrasound at these meetings. It's more likely to be discussed at the May or June meetings. And there is no guarantee, obviously, at that time that it will reach a conclusion. So it feels to me that there is still no real recognition of the issues that people with essential tremor face having to travel to London for an assessment and also back there if they're assessed as being suitable for the procedure. And there's also no acknowledgement of the waiting times people face and the impact that that's having on their lives. And that there are real fears that this decision will be further delayed beyond the spring or summer. And I think the committee know how long this petition has been before themselves and the previous committee. So I share Mary Ramsay's frustration that we appear to be moving at a snail's pace to bring this much needed treatment to patients in Scotland, and patients having to consider whether they join a waiting list in London where the treatment is available. But indeed, that is a long waiting list, and NHS England are looking to create another centre to deal due to the level of demand. And so it makes no sense to me whatsoever. We've got the equipment and we've got the knowledge here in Scotland, and we're not using it for our patients and forcing them to travel to access it. It's not good for them, and it's certainly not good for the public purse either. I'm not sure if you were aware, but 80 patients have been referred for assessment to Dundee last year from their own health boards, and around 25% of these patients are considered appropriate for treatment. So I would urge the committee to keep this petition open and put pressure on those committees to make sure that this treatment is approved as quickly as possible. And I think you already know that Mary Ramsay and Ian Sharp, who has had the treatment, are happy to give evidence to the committee about their own experience and show the firsthand the difference the treatment can make for those with essential tremor. And maybe also the committee could contact both the NPPRG and the NSSC to see if they could give priority to considering this treatment at their earlier meeting, because, as you said, convener, due to COVID, these committees have not met for a long time. Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Rhoda. That was very helpful. And quite disappointing as well in some respects. David Torrance.
Thank you, convener. I would like to keep this petition open just basically on the evidence from Dundee University and the success of it. And I would like to write to the Scottish Government to highlight the success of the MRGFUS treatment in ET patients and ask them for clarification as to when the pause on NSSC applications is likely to be removed. I'd also like to write to the Scottish Government whether it intends to provide funding for MRGFUS be made available for more ET patients in Scotland, and how they will raise awareness amongst the profession about this treatment for essential tremors. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I don't have an indication that any other committee member wishes to come in. So I think on the basis of David Torrance's suggestions and the contribution from Rhoda Grant, we are proposing to write to the Scottish Government, you know, highlighting the success in Dundee, and to ask when this pause is likely to be removed, to ask the Scottish Government whether it intends to provide dedicated funding to ensure ultrasound scanning can be made available to more patients in Scotland, and how it plans to raise awareness of essential tremor amongst patients and healthcare professionals. I'd like also just to take on board a couple of the organisations to which Rhoda Grant suggested we write, and sorry, Rhoda, I didn't actually get the acronyms fast enough, but they will be have noted by the clerks. But there were two specific committees I think you were quite keen that we write to as well, and so I would like to include them in our further submission. Are we all content with that? We are. Thank you very much. Thank you, and I think we're seeing you again a little bit later on, Rhoda. So look forward to that. Our second continued petition is petition number 1855, which is to pardon and memorialise those convicted under the Witchcraft Act of 1563. This is a petition lodged by Claire Mitchell QC, and can I just in the first instance apologise on behalf of the committee to Claire Mitchell, who may now be joining us, in that by way of an oversight, appropriate notice wasn't given that the petition was coming back to the committee this morning, and therefore an opportunity to submit further evidence to us was lost. But we, I think, will be later in the proceedings seeking to keep the petition open in any event, and look forward to that submission being received. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to pardon, apologise and create a national monument to memorialise those people in Scotland accused and convicted as witches under the Witchcraft Act of 1563. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 1st of September last year, and we decided to seek further information from the Scottish Government and the petitioner. And this was in relation to whether the royal prerogative of mercy could be used to achieve a pardon. The petitioner is seeking three things: the pardon, an apology, and a national memorial for those convicted under the Witchcraft Act in 1563. And further detail about this is provided to colleagues in their members' papers pack this morning. In relation to the pardon, the petitioner suggests that the royal prerogative of mercy is not a suitable vehicle to achieve their petitioner's aim, stating, and I quote, "We are not looking for a pardon in individual cases by Her Majesty the Queen, as the prosecutions were carried out by the Scottish state." The petitioner also states that an application to the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission, the SCCRC, to pardon individual people would not be competent, as there would be no one who could be considered to have a legitimate interest in terms of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act of 1995, quite obviously given the centuries of time that have passed since. Instead, the petitioner suggests there is a need for the Scottish Government to legislate to provide a pardon for all those convicted. The petitioner draws parallels with the Historical Sexual Offences, Pardons and Disregards Scotland Act 2018, in that it provided a collective and posthumous pardon. The petitioner suggests that the committee should ask the Scottish Government to provide a public apology to those convicted of witchcraft, making it clear that those convictions ought not to have happened and that these people were not witches. In its submission dated the 4th of November last year, the Scottish Government accepts that while the SCCRC can consider posthumous applications made on behalf of a convicted person, made by someone who would have standing to bring an appeal on their behalf, in practice, this will almost certainly not be possible. In terms of the royal prerogative of mercy, the Scottish Government advises, and I quote, "The First Minister will not generally consider recommending to Her Majesty a free pardon under the RPM process until that person's appeal against their conviction has been dismissed or leave to appeal has been refused, and any application to the SCCRC seeking to have the case referred to the appeal court has been rejected." In a further submission from the petitioner dated 5th of December 2021, the petitioner suggests that the committee may wish to consider a committee bill on this topic. Since then, we have received a submission from our colleague Natalie Dawn, NSP, who has indicated that she does intend to bring forward a members' bill to allow a pardon to take place. However, she notes that the two other asks in respect of this petition, i.e. to seek a public apology and to create a national monument, will not, as matters stand, fall within the scope of her bill. Now, this is where I hope that my microphone has been working for the last several minutes. Otherwise, there's a lot to be repeated. But on the assumption that it has been, I'm going to ask if members have any comments for action. And in the first instance, I'm going to go to Alexander Stewart.
Thank you very much, convener. There has been quite a lot of correspondence back and forward on this topic, and I note what the Scottish Government have said with reference to the process and the proceedings. And as you have already indicated, Ms Dawn, MSP, has also now come forward with her member's bill. And I think it would be at this stage appropriate for us to keep the petition open until we can establish what the member's bill is likely to proceed on, which topics. You have indicated that it may not be as broad as Ms Mitchell herself wants to progress, but I think it would be useful for us to have that in any case, and then also to consider inviting the Mitchell, the petitioner, to provide evidence to the committee at a future date. And depending on whether the members' bill will be allowed to progress under the auspices that Ms Dawn is trying to do. So I would recommend that that's what we would try to achieve with this, It isn't going to be easy, Convener, as you've already indicated. The Scottish Government have made some quite strong views and opinions with reference to it, but I think it is important that at this stage we continue to progress it.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I know Natalie Dawn's going to bring the Member's Bill and we don't know what it looks like, but I would still like to invite the petitioner to the committee to give evidence so we could base any future outcomes about the petition on that and take it forward.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. No other members of the committee have indicated that they wish to comment. So I think if I may summarise that we are keeping the petition open. It does look as though Natalie Dawn will be bringing forward a member's bill. I think we might require some clarification on our ability to progress the petition if a legislative bill is tabled and proceeding. But it looks in any event as if the scope of that bill may not be entirely comprehensive in relation to the scope of the petition. And therefore, I think we will keep in mind a desire to hear evidence from the petitioner at a future meeting and perhaps just clarify with Ms. Dawn when she might be likely to table that member's bill and to invite her to participate in the consideration of the petition on that date. Does that course of action meet with the approval of the committee? Thank you. Our third petition this morning, petition number 1873, is to provide hypnotherapy for the treatment of mental health, psychosomatic disorders and chronic pain, and it was lodged by Graham Harvey and considered last in September. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to instruct the National Health Service to provide hypnotherapy for the treatment of certain conditions. The Scottish Parliament's Research Centre has produced a summary of the available research on hypnotherapy conducted in other countries. It concludes that irritable bowel syndrome appears to be the condition with the most research on efficacy of hypnotherapy and that evidence of other conditions is more mixed. Submissions from the leads of Clinical Health Psychology, NHS Orkney and North Ayrshire Health and Social Care Partnership highlighted a lack of available evidence on the merits of hypnotherapy. The petitioner's recent submission reiterates various forms has been used for thousands of years. He also highlights that mindfulness and meditation are practices which are not new and have always been a part of hypnotherapy treatments. I should say I am myself a former convener of the cross-party group on chronic pain, which has considered these issues, and I believe Ruth Maguire is going to comment. Ruth.
Thank you, Convener. I should probably mention for the record, although it's not on my register of interest, I'm a former complementary therapist and used hypnotherapy in my practice. I've not been practicing for a number of years, but may well again in the future. I think taking on board the evidence and the feedback that we have from stakeholders, as you highlighted there in your opening, unfortunately, that there just isn't a lack of quality evidence that would enable them to recommend hypnotherapy as a treatment on the NHS. Scottish Government, of course, have also stated that it's up to individual NHS boards to decide which complementary and alternative medicines they use. I think that really we probably have to, on that basis, close the petition. However, I wonder if committee would be supportive of us writing to Sign and NICE and perhaps encouraging them to undertake a review of scientific literature, help healthcare professionals and patients understand the medical evidence relating to the issue of hypnotherapy for treatment of mental health, psychosomatic disorders and chronic pain. I think you mentioned the cross-party group on chronic pain, and I know a number of us will have anecdotal evidence of this being an effective tool and treatment for people, so I think it warrants a little more explanation.
Thank you, Ruth Maguire, for saying that, can I associate myself with those remarks? A course of action has therefore been recommended to the committee. Can I ask members if they are content with the recommendation as submitted as presented by Ruth Maguire. We are. Thank you. We move then to petition 1877 to provide body cameras for all frontline NHS staff, tabled by Alex Wallace. And again, we looked at this in September last. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide body cameras for all frontline NHS staff and paramedics in Scotland. Members should note that the Public Petitions Committee considered a similar petition from the same petition in Session 5. The committee wrote to stakeholders seeking their views. The British Medical Association has sent us a submission raising concerns about how body cameras might affect confidentiality and patient trust, suggesting body cameras could prevent a patient from seeking help or being honest about their situation were they to think that their remarks were being filmed. The Clerk's note accompanying this petition sets out data provided by the Scottish Ambulance Service on reports of physical or verbal abuse against their staff. The service notes that it has recently considered and approved a limited trial of body cameras. The service's submission sets out a number of perceived benefits to using these body cameras, including a potential reduction in staff absence due to assault, better quality footage supporting prosecutions, and wider improvements to staff well-being. Paul Sweeney, can I come to you in the first instance to comment?
Thank you, convener. Noted the petitioner's requests and indeed feedback we have already received, and certainly I note the feedback from the Scottish Government that they do not believe that body cams would necessarily be appropriate for all frontline clinical staff, given safety risks vary considerably across different job roles and obviously patient confidentiality issues. And that concern has been reiterated by the British Medical Association. So I think, you know, that issue around confidentiality, breach of trust, sensitivity of data protection. Appropriately wide. However, I do think there are certain instances where it may well be worth considering it more thoroughly, where it might be appropriate to apply such a device. And to that end, I would propose that we write to the Scottish Ambulance Service to request more information on the trial of body cameras, when it expects its trial to conclude, and how that those findings of the trial will be utilised, and also to further write to the Scottish Government to ask what engagement and plans it has to review the findings of the Scottish Ambulance Service trial, and then considering what plans it has to scale up such a measure or a trial, should it prove to be successful in its conclusions, deemed to be appropriate to do it more widely.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, convener. Yes, I see some merit in looking at the limited trial that is being put forward by the Scottish Ambulance Service, because, as Mr. Sweeney has already indicated, the risks and the confidentiality that are there for the others would possibly be too far. But I do believe that there is merit in seeing what the trial is looking at and how that might progress. So I'm keen to continue, and we'd be happy to support Paul Sweeney and the recommendations he's put forward.
Thank you. I think then, colleagues, we've taken note of the submission from the British Medical Association, but are minded to keep the petition open and to write to the Scottish Ambulance Service and the Scottish Government on the basis and terms suggested by Mr. Sweeney and supported by Mr. Stewart. Are we all agreed? I believe we are. Thank you. Our next petition is petition number 1878, the Investigate Prosecutions under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003. This was lodged by Andrew Muir and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to investigate why there have been so few prosecutions under sections 315 and 318 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003. We considered again this petition last on 22nd of September, and we decided then to write to the petitioner and to write the Scottish Mental Health Law Review to ask for an update on its work in relation to compulsory detention and care and treatment under the 2003 Act. The Scottish Mental Health Law Review responded to say that as part of its remit, it was considering patients' experiences of care and treatment while subject to compulsion, why there has been an increase in compulsory detention and treatment, and the reasons for variation in compulsory orders across Scotland. This includes issues of concern around accountability, complaint systems, and strengthening advocacy rights. A link to the full submission from the review can be found in members' papers. And I therefore invite comments and suggestions. In the first instance, I will go to David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. We have previously dealt with this petition last year, petition P1786, and I can't see any difference in the petition we are dealing with. So my recommendations would be to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders. The basis of issues in the petition raises fall within the scope of the Scottish Mental Health Law Review, and we have had a really in-depth submission from them on it. So I can't see your committee taking this anywhere else. So I'm happy to close it.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. Members, the recommendation from Mr. Torrance is that we close the petition under Rule 15.7. Are we agreed to do that? We are. Thank you very much. Our next petition is petition number 1881, Longer Sentences for Paedophiles and Sexual Predators, lodged by Carol Burns and last considered in September 21, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the length of time sexual predators serve in jail. At that meeting, the committee requested an update from the Scottish Sentencing Council on progress developing sentencing guidelines in relation to rape, sexual assault and indecent images of children. The committee also sought an update from Rape Crisis Scotland and Victim Support Scotland. And we've now received a submission from the Scottish Sentencing Council, which provides information about the development of three general guidelines. These will create a high-level framework for sentencing and a foundation for the development of offence-specific sentencing guidelines. Work on the development of guidelines on rape, sexual assault and indecent images of children is now at stage two, which focuses on engaging with key stakeholders, gathering evidence and developing a first draft for each guideline. The SSC is not yet in a position to set out a definitive timescale for the publication of the guidelines. In its submission, Rapes Crisis Scotland shares the petitioner's concern that some sentences feel disproportionately short to those affected by the crime, and Rape Crisis Scotland welcomes the SSC's review of sentencing guidelines. Can I come, therefore, to members for comment and, in the first instance, to Alexander Stewart?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, there is no doubt that the high-level framework that is progressing, and I do think that the Scottish Sentencing Council have put a huge amount of effort into this. So I would suggest at this stage that we close the petition under Rule 15.7, and the Scottish Sentencing Council is currently developing a set of sentencing guidelines, which you've already indicated with reference to the rape, sexual assault and indecent images. And in closing the petition, the committee could write to the petitioner suggesting that she engages with the development of the guidelines, specifically when it comes to the research project on rape and sexual assault. With that process in mind, the committee could share the petitioner's details with the Scottish Sentencing Council to ensure that there would be that dialogue and discussion between the petitioner and the council itself. And I think that is the best way forward at this stage on this whole process.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I take note of the recommendation that you have put in addition to your suggestion that we close the petition. I turn to the committee to see if they are in agreement with that course of action. We are, so can I thank the petitioner, Carol Burns, in closing the petition and very much hope that she does engage with the Scottish Sentencing Council in relation to the development of the guidelines now underway. Petition number 1883, open all toddler and baby activities within Tier 3 of COVID-19 future pandemic lockdowns, lodged by Katrina Clark. And calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to allow baby and toddler activities to be considered equally with other outdoor activities in Tier 3 of future lockdowns, last considered by us in November. And we wrote to the Scottish Government a range of the issues highlighted. The Scottish Government stated in response that no formal analysis has been carried out in relation to baby and toddler groups. However, engagement has taken place with member organisations. Small grant funds were set up to support smaller organisations, and children's rights impact assessments and business regulatory impact assessments were undertaken at each stage of the pandemic. The Scottish Government and Public Health Scotland are currently working to understand what impacts from the pandemic might be on children aged up to 3 years of age and what actions could be taken to improve that impact. The petitioner has subsequently highlighted that there are similar risks associated with baby and toddler groups to those assessed for soft play centres. Yet soft play centres were allowed to open in Tier 3 and baby and toddler groups were not. I ask if any of the committee have any comments to make, and in the first instance turn to Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. I think that obviously, hopefully, we're seeing a bit of light at the end of the tunnel in terms of the pandemic, but we know that from the Scottish Government that they're unable to completely rule out further COVID-19 related restrictions or advise what they might be in the future. I do think this is a really important topic. There won't be many families that haven't been impacted, and I think anyone who's has young children or indeed has ever had has older children and can remember will appreciate how important these activities are for children's development and for their well-being, and indeed the well-being of the mums and dads that are going to them. However, I think based on the fact that the government can't rule out further restrictions, we probably have to close the petition. I do think we should write to the Scottish Government and explore the further issues that Katrina Clark raised with the committee. I would also want to highlight to her the inquiry into the handling of the pandemic. I think she, you know, in raising this petition, there's an example of a group of society, be it children and babies and their parents, who have been impacted by actions that have taken place. So there's, you know, it's a legitimate area for the inquiry to look into.
Thank you, Ruth Maguire. I just want to be clear. I mean, I think we are going to close the petition. Is that what you're recommending? Yeah. I think the issues are sufficiently important that we would very much encourage the petitioner, Katrina Clark, to contribute to the inquiry, which will no doubt encompass the issues related when it is in due course convened. Is that correct?
Yes. That's absolutely correct, and I'm sure as individual MSPs, we'll all be mindful of the matters that she's raised as well going forward.
Are the committee content to proceed on the basis of Ruth Maguire's recommendation? We are. Thank you. Our next petition is petition number 1888, a full legal protection for hedgehogs and moles, which was lodged by Joseph Allen, and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to grant full legal protection to hedgehog and moles, and was last considered on November the 3rd. Last, at that meeting, we agreed to write to Hogwatch, the Scottish Wildlife Trust, and the Mammal Society, and we have had responses from Hogwatch Scotland Project, operated by the Conservation Volunteers in Scotland, and the Scottish Wildlife Trust. In their submission, Hogwatch Scotland reiterate that hedgehog numbers in Britain have fallen from an estimated 30 million in the 1960s to just 1.5 million in recent years. Hogwatch Scotland notes with concern that whilst the Scottish Biodiversity List categorises hedgehogs in the watching brief only category, this means hedgehogs are considered of less concern and only require monitoring. Hogwatch Scotland considers that the declines already shown by current estimates require a more proactive approach. It also believes that increasing the level of protection afforded to hedgehogs in Scotland and raising awareness about their conservation could drive conservation efforts from the public, particularly in urban settings. In its submission, the Scottish Wildlife Trust, hereafter the Trust, explains that it is very concerned about the decline in hedgehog numbers, which is highlighted by the fact that it is currently considered vulnerable to extinction on the Red List for Scottish mammals. Furthermore, the Trust would like to see concerted action to protect hedgehogs and other vulnerable species by increasing legal protection and directly addressing the causes of their decline. The Trust's view is there does not seem to be evidence to suggest that moles have experienced similar declines to those of hedgehogs. However, the Trust believes that more needs to be done to mitigate the impact that human activity has on all biodiversity. The Trust believes this is especially important if we are to achieve the Scottish Government's ambition to address both the nature and climate crises together. I think the fact, colleagues, is that we I've been advised by the Scottish Government that they are awaiting the outcome of the JNCC review, which is not due for publication until early spring, and will then require scrutiny before any policy actions can be taken, albeit there clearly is very widespread concern supporting the issues that the petitioner has raised. I'm therefore minded to recommend that, notwithstanding that, we close the petition and very much look forward ourselves to the consideration of the JNCC review. Are colleagues minded to support that course of action? We are. Thank you. Can I also inform the committee that very sadly our colleague Colette Stevenson, MSP, has intimated the committee that the petitioner, Mr. Allen, has died since we last considered this petition. And obviously very sorry to receive that news, and I would very much like to pass on the committee's sincere condolences to Mr. Allen's family and to thank them for the petition that Mr. Allen raised and brought to the committee's attention, which I hope will receive appropriate consideration when that review is forthcoming. We now move to petition number 1889, financial support for self-employed people in the travel industry. This is lodged by Nikki Peachy and encourages the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide tailored financial solution support to self-employed individuals working in the travel industry whose businesses have been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic, and indeed who have been on the campus of the Scottish Parliament lobbying MSPs directly. We last considered the petition in November last, and at that meeting we agreed to write to Scottish Government and industry representatives. A response has been received from the APTA, the Travel Association, and in its submission states that summer 2021 failed to deliver a meaningful restart for the travel sector. APTA recently conducted a survey on behalf of the Safe Future Travel Coalition, which reported that the value of new bookings taken across summer and early autumn last year represented on average only 31% of the value of new bookings taken over the pre-pandemic period in 2019. APTA notes that the self-employed travel agents operate a variety of different business models, and as such are only able to access part of the grants that have been made available. The submission explains that some staff have been required to issue refunds and manage booking requests on behalf of clients. HMRC's data shows uptake of furlough by travel agencies and tour operators at the 30th of April 21 was only 49% compared to 70% in hospitality. APTA believes that many of the grant funding schemes in Scotland have failed to recognise the impact of unique restrictions placed on travel. Many local authority administered schemes focused on physical constraints of COVID-19, such as the closure of premises or social distancing measures. The submission explains that schemes such as temporary closure grants were only applicable to retail travel agents when premises were required to close, whereas online travel agents, tour operators and travel agent home workers were ineligible for this funding. As such, travel businesses without a rateable premise were not eligible for one-off travel agent fund payment launched by the Scottish Government in January 21, or the Restart Grant Scheme. And furthermore, APTA advises it is aware that many independent agents within their membership have had to remortgage or sell homes in order to keep their businesses alive. APTA highlights support schemes offered by the Northern Ireland Assembly, such as the Northern Ireland Executives Limited Company Director Support Scheme, LCDSS, which provided an initial one-off taxable grant of £3,500 to eligible company directors in January 2021. And it also highlights the Northern Ireland Travel Agent Coronavirus Financial Assistance Scheme 2021, which included a one-off single payment of £3,500 for self-employed travel agents working from home, which was clearly a different approach. And I come to Paul Sweeney in the first instance among colleagues to comment. Mr. Sweeney.
You know, I share the concerns raised by the petitioner, having had dealings personally on a constituency basis with Barhead Travel, one of the largest travel agents in the UK. They have raised concerns that the package of support that was designed largely for inbound tourism, so for hotels and hospitality venues that might, or tourist attractions in Scotland, that might be affected by the cessation of inbound tourism. But there has been similar consideration given to businesses that are involved with outbound tourism, and particularly travel agents. It's very much geared to travel agencies with premises. But even then, the way the scheme is constructed, even businesses with multiple premises don't necessarily qualify for support, even though a company like Barhead Travel, for example, employs like nearly 500 people. So I think there is a major concern there that there is a gap in the way the system and the schemes have been designed. And I think the Northern Ireland model certainly holds up a benchmark that is well worth investigation. I did raise this matter with Ivan McKee, the minister, before Christmas. And I wasn't convinced by his response. He sort of made a point about having engaged with Barhead Travel, and they effectively were disputing the fact that they'd been engaged by him. So there's clearly a bit of an issue there about the level of engagement with the industry, and not to mention the actual design of the support structures. Clearly, people are feeling that they're being let down. So I think that is very appropriate for us to sort of interrogate this matter further, and would consider writing to the Scottish Government to raise the specific issue of the Northern Ireland scheme and why that hasn't been emulated, and perhaps seeking evidence from stakeholders further afield. I would nominate Barhead Travel, for example, but there may be other examples of major participants in the sector that would be worth investigating their position on the issue as well.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. That was quite comprehensive. I have not got an indication at the moment of any other colleagues wishing to intervene. So I think we are going to hold this petition open, and write to the Cabinet Secretary of Finance and Economy on the basis Mr. Sweeney suggested, and in particular drawing her attention the package of support measures that were implemented in Northern Ireland, which seem to have maybe more directly responded to the aims of the petitioner. Are colleagues agreed with that course of action? We are. Thank you all very much. Our next petition is petition number 1891, making swimming lessons a statutory requirement in the primary school curriculum, lodged by Lewis Alexander Conde, and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all children will have had the opportunity to learn to swim by making it a statutory requirement to provide lessons in the primary school curriculum. I'm delighted to say we're joined by our colleague Faisal Chowdhury, MSP, to the committee this morning. Good morning, Mr. Chowdhury. And I'll be inviting him to speak in a second or so. But before I do, let me just provide a little bit more background to those following proceedings. We last considered the petition in November, where we agreed to write to COSLA seeking data on how many schools provide swimming lessons as part of the curriculum, and we also wrote to the Royal Society for the Prevention of Accidents and Scottish Swimming. In COSLA's submission, it states that currently there are no local or national mechanisms in place to collect this data, noting that delivery of swimming lessons can depend on factors including access to facilities, cost and delivery model. The latest figures held pre-pandemic, 2018-19, suggest that 21 local authorities were offering swimming activity through the Active Schools network. Scottish Swimming notes in its submission that there were over 106,000 children enrolled in Learn to Swim programmes prior to the pandemic. It also highlights data which suggests that there is a direct correlation between a child's socioeconomic background and their opportunity to learn to swim. Scottish Swimming states that it has submitted a proposal to the Scottish Government in support of a programme of school swimming, and is currently involved in discussions with Sport Scotland over its potential development. We also received a submission to the Royal Society for the Prevention of Accidents, which highlights the need for any swimming programme to include consideration of outdoor water survival skills. The petitioner suggests that the current policy of allowing councils to choose whether to provide swimming lessons is unfair, leading to many children missing out or being forced to take private lessons, something which many may be increasingly inaccessible to lower income families or actually those who are living in rural areas. Before I turn to members of the committee, I'd welcome Mr. Chowdhury. Would you like to comment on the aims of the petition?
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I would like to again thank my constituent, Lewis Conde, who has brought an important issue to the Parliament attention and provided considered response to the Scottish Government submission. This is a good example of positive citizen engagement with the Scottish Parliament. Lewis has throughout emphasised the importance of equality of access to swimming lessons. Inequality of access is a big problem, as highlighted repeatedly in the response to the committee, and a key failure in the current situation. I would like to thank all those who signed the petition and those organisations that have responded to committee's request for more information. They have provided a wealth of evidence both about the value of swimming lessons and the factors influencing the inequalities in access to them. In the response from Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, COSLA, I note the following points. Scottish Government has previously answered a written question in Parliament from me, asking about swimming lessons and about competency level in primary school children, which said that information was not held centrally. I'm very much concerned and disappointed to learn that COSLA confirms that not only is there no data to indicate the presence of swimming lessons across Scotland, there is not even a mechanism to collect said data. They also note that variations in swimming lessons provisions across the country, with the availability of facilities, that cost of lesson being significant factor driving unequal access. Although extra circular support of the Active Schools Network is highlighted, only 21 local authorities offering swimming activities through the network, and it is not known how many children that actually reaches. The response from Scottish Swimming confirms that concerns raised by the petitioner Lewis Condy. Scottish Swimming reiterate Mr. Condy's initial concern that over 40% of children level primary education are unable to swim. Furthermore, the note that only just over 10% of children in swimming lessons through their Learn to Swim framework come from the most deprived areas of Scotland, and that there is a direct correlation between a child socioeconomic background and their opportunity to learn to swim. If they're serious about tackling inequalities, we need a very different approach. Finally, Royal Society of the Prevention of Accident, ROSPA, note that in England, despite swimming being a statutory part of the national curriculum, a significant number of children leave primary education without being able to swim. They highlight that no issue regarding equality of access, including that it is affected by family affluence and location. The ROSA evidence indicates that swimming lessons as a statutory requirement might not in itself be a panacea. Making swimming lesson mandatory without support for and from the organisations that would need to be involved in delivery may not have the desired effects. So a whole package of measures require consideration. There is also evidence available through other sources in England and Wales that identifying particular barriers to accessing swimming regularly among some ethnic minority communities, the proportionality fewer children able to swim and be confident in water safety. In conclusion, and I thank committee colleagues for allowing me this opportunity to speak. We have seen form of responses from my constituents' petition. There is widespread support with the sector for doing more on this issue. The committee has heard that there is no statutory curriculum in Scotland. However, the Scottish Government has previously found means to mandate an inclusive education in other areas where it has deemed this necessary. This is at the at its heart a question of social justice as much as it is a question of education. The committee has heard that there are significant social disparities in the provision of swimming lessons. We know that access to swimming lessons give people a benefit to their safety and around water and to their health, fitness and well-being. Resolving their disparities is a matter of equality of opportunity. This is an issue that this public support, clear support from the sector involved, and would provide a significant benefit to the society if properly addressed. I would finally suggest that there have been many points raised by the organizations involved in the area which the committee might wish to put to the Cabinet Secretary herself for further comments. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chowdhury, and a number of quite important issues raised there, and thank you again for contributing to your constituents' petition this morning. I turn now to members of the committee, and in the first instance to David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and I'd like to thank the petitioner for bringing this petition forward. It's a real important issue. You just need to see from the number of tragedies this summer, this year in Scotland, with the number of people who couldn't learn to swim. And learning to swim could be a lifesaver, and that's why it's so important. I know there can be difficulties around locations, geographical, the lack of swimming facilities, but I'd like to explore this more, because when you see the evidence from COSLAD, Scottish Swimming, and the Royal Society for the Prevention of Accidents, it's really important that we try to encourage every primary school child to learn to swim. And as I said before, it will save a life. So I would like to ask for an update from the Scottish Government on the proposals to work with Scottish Swimming and Sport Scotland on a programme of school swimming, including who might benefit from this. I'd also like to comment from Mr. Chowdhury about data, explore with the Scottish Government how we could collect data and the number of primary school children who are able to swim at the end of a primary school and how it can be collected. But I would also like to account for the factors, the child's geographical location, socio-economic background and ethnic background, because I think they are really important as well, and it will highlight where we are missing out. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Torrance. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to congratulate Mr. Chowdhury for making such an eloquent case on behalf of his constituent, the petitioner, and thank him for coming to the committee. And I agree with the points that he raised, and also Mr. Torrance and his comments as well. Certainly, it's an issue that's been brought up time and time again with me in my time as a representative in Glasgow, particularly the Spears family, who have tragically lost their son, and have launched the last few years the Christopher Saving Lives campaign after their son tragically drowned in the River Clyde. And having met the Glasgow Humane Society as well, they've raised a number of recurring issues about a lack of confidence when people encounter difficulty, particularly in open water and in tidal waters, as well as a lack of respect for life-saving equipment that's often frequently vandalised and removed by often young people, and I think there is an issue around general education in this area. Teaching kids to swim is a fundamental life-saving exercise. It's not a recreational activity necessarily, and I think that's the fundamental consideration. It's a public safety matter rather than it being a sporting matter, and I think that needs to be the consideration and the basis on which we take this forward. Furthermore, I think the issue around infrastructure in certain councils may well be a valid concern. You know, not every school now has a swimming pool or ready access to leisure centres, etc. However, we might also want to consider education in the form of open water swimming and open water confidence. Certainly, outdoor education was a big part of my primary education, and that might well be a consideration because it's actually confidence in open water that is the main issue. We saw the tragedy, was mentioned at Loch Lomond, for example, this summer when young people get into difficulty. So I think that is a major consideration we need to take into cognizance here. And that may well not have the same issues in terms of physical infrastructure, because there's plenty of opportunities to experience open water swimming in Scotland at relatively low cost. And it's just a matter of actually introducing children to that environment and also explaining some of the hidden dangers of those kind of waters. Certainly speaking to the Glasgow Humane Society, for example, they described how actually mud is one of the main safety issues in the river. So a lot of people actually drown because it's not because they can't swim, it's because they get stuck in the mud and they actually can't physically remove themselves from the river and they drown in that basis, which is a particularly distressing sounding situation for someone to be in. So it's not for want of being able to swim, it's actually unawareness that the how treacherous the riverbanks can be. So that's the kind of broader spectrum of education I think we really need to introduce to our schools.
Thank you, Paul. That was very helpful as well. And I think quite a comprehensive discussion this morning. I don't have an indication from other members of the committee they wish to come in. So I would like to thank Faisal Chowdhury for joining us. I think we are keeping Mr. Conde's petition open, and we will write as David Torrance has suggested, but I think we might also include some of the themes that Paul Sweeney has introduced in relation not just to swimming in the way I think most people traditionally have thought of people being taught to swim in a controlled environment in a swimming pool, but the life-saving benefits of wild water swimming, for want of a better description, in its widest sense, as described, I think, during the conversation we've just had, to seek maybe slightly broader than the range of the petition, but what more could be done to try and progress this issue in a way that would save lives, even if ultimately the objective of the petition in relation to swimming pools is slightly impractical for certain local authorities. But I think there's a very, very important issue at the heart of this. So we keep the petition open and progress further information on that basis. Does the committee agree? We are. Thank you again, Mr. Chowdhury, for joining us this morning. Our next petition is petition number 1894 to permit a medical certificate of cause of death to be independently reviewed, lodged by Kenneth Robertson. The petition was last considered in November, and at that time we agreed to write to the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service and Healthcare Improvement Scotland to seek their views on the petition. It calls on the Scottish Government to change the Certification of Death Scotland Act 2011 to permit a medical certificate of cause of death, an MCCD, to be independently reviewed by a medical reviewer from the Death Certification Review Service, where the case has already been reviewed by the Procurator Fiscal, but not by a medical professional expert. The Scottish Government submission highlights that the Death Certification Review Service, the DCRS, checks the accuracy of approximately 12% of all medical certificates of cause of death in Scotland. It also carries out interested person reviews in cases where questions or concerns about certificates remain after speaking with the certifying doctor. The Scottish Government suggests that given the COPFS is independent and has the responsibility to investigate these, it would not be appropriate for Death Certification Review Service to review medical certificates of cause of death in cases already investigated by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. Healthcare Improvement Scotland, in its submission to the committee, provides further information about the work of the review service, including as part of its inquiries, service for certifying doctors. It also notes that since it was established in 2015, the monthly median percentage of cases where the certifying doctor has made a clinical or administrative error has reduced from 44 to 24.4%. The submission also sets out the circumstances in which a referral might be made to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. The Lord Advocate states in her submission that in establishing what should be stated on a medical certificate of cause of death, the Procurator Fiscal, and I quote, may seek an independent medical opinion, for example, from a pathologist, for their view on the appropriate MCCD or whether anything would be gained from conducting a post-mortem examination. The Lord Advocate suggests that it would not be appropriate for DCRS to review MCCS in cases already investigated by Procurators Fiscal. In the light of the submissions we've received, I welcome comments from colleagues, and in the first instance, go to Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, convener. You've outlined, and the information that we've received outlines where we are with this process. And at the last time of us dealing with this back in November, as I say, we did write, and we have had correspondence which you've gone through from individuals and organisations who have got some very strong views as to where we are with this petition. So I note all of those, and I do believe that under the circumstances that this petition should now close under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders, because we have sought views from the Lord Advocate and the Health Improvement Scotland, and both of these organisations and individuals believe that it would be inappropriate for the Death Certificate Review Service to review medical death certificates and cause of death in the cases that they have already been investigated by the Procurator Fiscal. So I think that we have exhausted most of what we can do as a committee on this occasion. And as I say, because of that, I would suggest that we close the petition at this case.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Stewart. No other member has indicated they wish to come in. I do want to thank Mr. Robertson for bringing the petition to us. I think it raised an important matter. However, I think the responses we've now received from Scottish Government and from the various legal bodies is such that Mr. Stewart's recommendation that we close the petition is one I'm putting to committee members to seek their support for. Are we agreed? And it appears that we are. So thank you all very much. That is the conclusion of item two. We now move to item three, which is the consideration of new petitions. And again, can I say to anybody tuning in this morning to see their petition considered for the first time, that before the committee does consider it, we do seek the views of the Scottish Government on all new petitions before we formally consider them. And the responses that we have received in advance do form notes to members in their papers ahead of the consideration here at committee. The first of this morning's new petitions is petition number 1909 to remove the, and in inverted commas, gender-based crime domestic abuse narrative and make it gender neutral and equal, and has been lodged by William Wright. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make domestic abuse policies, guidance, agendas and practices gender neutral, to introduce equal domestic abuse provision and funding for everyone in Scotland, regardless of any protected characteristic, and to ensure all domestic abuse joint protocol guidance, policies and practice for Police Scotland and the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service are gender neutral. The Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government outlines a number of key statistics in her submission, evidencing that domestic abuse is predominantly perpetrated by men against women, such as women who were nearly three times more likely to be killed by a partner or ex-partner. And 95% of charges reported by the police to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service in 2021 involved a male alleged perpetrator. However, it is acknowledged that the statistics do not mean that men and boys cannot be the victims of domestic abuse. The submission also points out that provisions in criminal law used to prosecute domestic abuse are gender neutral and apply equally to all perpetrators. The Cabinet Secretary's submission also highlights several funded services for male victims and notes that the 21-22 programme for government included a commitment to establishing a national strategy on ending intimate and sexual violence against men and boys. The petitioner suggests that Scottish Government's Equally Safe Work, which describes women and girls as being higher risk, alongside Police Scotland and COPFS guidance on domestic abuse, risk creating a bias against violence against men and women. Men and boys. Apologies. Do members have any comments or suggestions? And I am going to go in the first instance to Ruth McGuire. Ruth.
Thank you, Convener. I think as the CAV Secretary's statistics and her submission highlight, you know, the causes and consequences of violence are different for men than women, as are the approaches that we need to take to prevent and hopefully one day eradicate that violence. I suggest that we press the Scottish Government, that we write to them and seek further details on the national strategy that you mentioned, that strategy on ending intimate and sexual violence against men and boys, and in our letter that we ask for a timescale for publication as well. I think it would also be helpful to write to Police Scotland and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, seeking their views on the petition. It would also be helpful, I think, to hear from the services that are targeted towards men and boys that are mentioned in our papers, Respect Men's Advice Line, Assist, and SARCO's Fear-Free Service. Thank you.
Thank you, Ruth. No other member has at the moment indicated that they wish to... Mr. Sweeney, was that you indicating you'd like to come in?
No. Right, I'm all right, thank you. Convener.
It was just a loose hand, not a family pet or anything that caught my attention there. Thank you. I think we thank Mr. Wright for his petition, which we intend to keep open, and we will write to the various organisations as identified, government bodies and organisations as identified by Ruth McGuire. Has the committee agreed to that process? We are. Thank you. Petition number 1912, funding for council venues, has been lodged by Wendy Dunsmore. Calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide the necessary additional revenue to local councils to run essential services and venues. It's worth noting that the SPICE briefing relating to this petition, the Scottish Government submission and petitioner submission were all written before the Scottish Government budget of 22-23 was published on the 9th of December 21. And key points from a separate SPICE briefing on local government finance following the budget's publication include, once additional revenue and capital grants are factored in, the total local government settlement increased by 603 million, that's 5.1% between 21-2 and 22-23. And there will be a real times increase in provisional revenue allocations for all local authorities except the Western Isles Council, Shetland Isles Council and Orkney Islands Council, who all see small real times reductions. The Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth highlights the 21-22 settlement of £11.7 billion, stating that it saw a cash increase in local government spending. The petitioner's submission is a collective response to the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth from Unite, Unison and from the GMB. They recognise that local authorities make decisions about service provision and delivery. However, they note that it is not without, and I quote, unfair challenges caused by real times the terms reduction in funding. The submission points out that much of the £11.7 billion settlement figure is ring-fenced for Scottish Government commitments. Therefore, it is not technically available for local authority spending decisions. I invite comments from colleagues on the committee and an indication from Mr. Sweeney that he would like to comment. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I think the long-running issue of council finances in Scotland has been an issue, and it's been a one of long-term decline, certainly over the last decade. I think the overall figure is 10 pence in every pound that a council has to spend in Scotland has been cut on average in the last decade. And bearing in mind that 80% of a council's budget is set by the Scottish Government, the power over that decision largely lies with central government. Only 20% of a council's finances can be raised through local charges in the council tax. Therefore, the capacity for local government to generate its own income is constrained. Furthermore, we've seen from the SPICE report an increase in the level of ring fencing taking place. So the slice of an overall council's budget that is subject to strings attached, where that funding can't be used on a discretionary basis, or has to be displaced from existing budget lines into delivering Scottish Government mandated projects. So effectively, it's a way of funding central government priorities indirectly through stealth, but actually displacing existing budget demands of local government. So that compounds the financial pressure faced by councils. And whereas I accept that the latest figures on SPICE require updating, I think, from what I can discern, the pressure hasn't relented on local government, and that's indicated by the recent reports that every council leader in Scotland across parties has written to the First Minister requesting an emergency meeting to discuss council financing. But I think that indicates that regardless of party affiliation, this is a major issue confronting local government. All 32 leaders of the councils through COSLA were seeking an emergency meeting with the First Minister to discuss this issue. So I think the acuteness of the matter hasn't abated, and therefore I think the concerns raised are valid, and I think it'd be worthwhile us seeking latest figures and the latest impacts, and also taking a longer term view of the situation facing local government finance. What I find quite problematic in the Minister's response to the committee is absolute figures in isolation don't really illustrate the problem. I think you have to really look at it in context of percentages. What is the percentage position relative to previous year, you know, and also looking at it, cash terms in isolation isn't necessarily helpful when we've seen an inflationary spiral in the last year and likely significant pressures on wages coming forward in the next financial year. So I think all these things need to be properly unpacked and considered properly, rather than just having, you know, figures that sound impressive on the face of it thrown at you when you don't really understand the full context of what's going on. So I think on that basis, I wasn't entirely convinced by the response, and I think there is still valid merit in this in continuing this petition on that basis to gather further evidence.
Thank you very much, Paul. No other member has indicated that they wish to come in at this stage. That was a very comprehensive contribution. I think on the back of that, we want to thank Wendy Dunsmore for her petition, which we are going to keep open. And there were a series of stakeholders identified by Mr. Sweeney, to whom I think we now will seek views on the issues raised in the petition. Are we agreed to proceed on that basis? We are. Thank you. Petition number 1914. To ban school uniforms in secondary schools. This is our penultimate petition today and lodged by Matthew Lewis Simpson. Calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to remove the requirement for school uniforms in secondary schools. The petitioner sets out several reasons why he believes this should happen, including the fact that uniforms are uncomfortable, costly, and that they interfere with students being able to express their individuality. The Scottish Government's submission makes it clear that there is no legislative requirement in place in Scotland which legally requires the wearing of school uniforms. Instead, school uniform policy is a matter for local authorities and individual schools. The Scottish Government states that it would not support a proposal to ban school uniforms at any school in Scotland. The submission sets out a number of perceived advantages to wearing school uniform, which include reducing competition between pupils in respect of expensive clothing brands. It reduces bullying, it creates a positive image of a school in a local community, and improves school security, allowing staff to identify anyone who does not belong to the school easily. The Scottish Government acknowledges the petitioner's concerns about buying school uniforms, recognising that this can be one of the most significant costs for families and that this can be a source of anxiety for low-income families. The submission explains that the Scottish Government recently increased the amounts paid for school clothing grants. The Scottish Government is committed to introducing statutory guidance and uniforms for schools and local authorities during the lifetime of this parliamentary session, which it states will cover the affordability of school uniforms, the consideration of equalities issues when deciding school uniform policies, and considerations for physical education classes. The Scottish Government concludes by highlighting a public consultation on proposed school uniform guidance, which is due to be launched in the new year. Do we have comments and suggestions for action? And I note David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to keep this petition open. I know the Scottish Government says in its submission it would not ban outright wearing of school uniforms across Scotland, but I think there's merit in finding out when the Scottish Government will establish its school uniform consultation and when it will be published. So I'd also like to write to him. I'd also like to write to views of other relevant stakeholders, like the Scottish Youth Parliament, to seek their views, Children and Young People's Commissioner, and the National Parent Forum of Scotland to find out what their views are on the petition. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. I have no indication. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. It's just a matter, I mean, I personally think the school uniform is a good thing. That might be my ex-army background coming into it, but I think the idea of the uniform is a fine thing, and it builds school identity, etc. But I won't rehearse all the arguments about it, because I think they've been had before. But I think a wider consideration is the financial effect of school uniform, and you know, some of the financial pressures faced by families as well. There's been some interesting innovations in that regard, particularly in Glasgow, with the Glasgow Pre-Loved Uniform Service, which was set up by Donna Henderson. And it's basically an exchange, because a lot of kids are growing so fast that the clothing they might outgrow, but it's perfectly reusable. And they've been trying to sort of reduce waste as well as address some issues, perhaps of financial exclusion, by introducing clothing rails in schools around Glasgow and trying to allow people to exchange items of uniform, refurbish uniform. So when we're thinking about, you know, the issue about uniforms as well, we might want to think about how they are provided to kids, and also looking at ways in which we can make the process more sustainable, and reduce the turnover of uniform items that go to waste. So it might be a person that might be worth considering taking evidence from, because I think Ms. Henderson's done a fantastic job in Glasgow.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney, and I take note of that, and we may welcome back to it. I mean, I like you, wore a school uniform. I know that's more than half a century ago now, but I don't know if it fell out of fashion or not. But my own experience was that there was a very active facilitation of secondhand school uniforms managed at that time. In fact, I think there were even retail outlets that organised the sale and receipt of secondhand uniforms. Because you're absolutely right. It very often there's a long shelf life left in a school uniform item, from which has only become available because of a very fast growing young person. So I mean, I think that's very, very correct. In the first instance, recommendations from Mr. Torrance are that we obviously keep Mr. Simpson's petition open, and we write to the various agencies as described by Mr. Torrance. We'll then hear what they've got to say and consider the petition again on receipt of their submissions. Is the committee agreeable? We are. Thank you very much. That brings us to our last new petition this morning, petition number 1916. To request a public inquiry into the management of the Rest on Be Thankful, lodged by Councillor Douglas Spilland and Councillor Donald Kelly. And as promised, I'm delighted to welcome back Rhoda Grant to the meeting for the final petition this morning, and I will come to her again shortly. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to instigate a public inquiry regarding the political and financial management of the A83 Rest to Be Thankful project, which is to provide a permanent solution for the route. In its submission, Transport Scotland explains that following a number of landslides across Scotland in 2004, a nationwide Scottish road network landslide study was carried out, and the study concluded that the A83 Ardgartan to Rest and Be Thankful is one of the most highly ranked debris flow hazard sites in Scotland. A study was commissioned by Transport Scotland in 2012 to identify and appraise potential options to minimise the effects of road closures. The final A83 route study, published the following February 2013, explains that the decision was made to progress with the red option, which was considered at that time to offer the best performance and most cost-effective way of meeting the study's objectives. Those objectives included maintaining the existing alignment of the A83, to include a range of landslide mitigation measures, such as additional debris flow barriers at locations where the landslide hazard was considered highest, to improve hillside drainage adjacent to and under the road, and to introduce vegetation and planting on the slope. In its submission, Transport Scotland provides a range of data which shows the number of days those various stretches of road in and around the A83 were closed due to landslides, And the data shows that the scale of the events, which occurred in 2020 and 2021, was significantly larger than any of the previous events. Following this, several new measures were introduced in order to make it quicker, easier and safer to open the road should it be closed by a landslide. A consultation exercise was carried out in 2020 to consider 11 route corridor options to address issues at the Rest and Be Thankful route. Over 650 people provided feedback, with the Glencrow corridor being chosen as the preferred route. Transport Scotland submission advises the timescales for completion of a long-term solution to the issues at the Rest and Be Thankful range from 7 to 10 years. In the interim, Transport Scotland advises that work is progressing to look at a medium-term resilient route through Glencrow, and that work will seek to develop a finalised proposal by the autumn of this year. The submission ends by stating that since the A83 task force, which was set up in 2012, have held meetings every 6 months, and a substantial project update at the next task force meeting is due in early 2022. A project-specific web page was also launched on the Transport Scotland website. Against that background, I'm happy to invite Rhoda Grant to comment. Rhoda.
Thank you, Convener. And as you've said, over the last 14 years, the Rest and Be Thankful has been for quite a number of occasions and has cost over £87 million in efforts to keep it open and indeed keep traffic safe. You referred to the large landslide in August 2020, where 10,000 tonnes of debris fell both on the A83 and also on the old military road. Now, the old military road is used as a temporary route when the A83 is closed and sits in the valley below. So the traffic could neither use the A83 or the temporary old military road, and had a 60-mile additional journey over the A82 because of that closure. And when it reopened after that, another landslide occurred in September, and it had only been open 6 days at that point. So for those months, it led to the A83 being open for less than 50% of a time. That's the 4 months at the end of 2020. And an economic impact looked at what this had cost locally between August 2020 and March 2021, and they estimated that £5.5 million was lost to the local economy, and that didn't take account of potential economic development that has gone elsewhere just because of the uncertainty over the route. And depopulation is also a big issue in the area, and this will get worse because of the uncertainty over the route. As you said, the options were consulted on and they have come up with the preferred solution of following a similar route. But this requires quite a lot of work to go on, examining rerouting and also looking at building a viaduct or a tunnel. And also there is a medium-term solution through Glencrow being discussed as well. And there's real frustration locally about the length of time this is taking and indeed the amount of money it's costing. And we also know that there is 100,000 tonnes of unstable material that will risk lives and livelihoods in Argyll. If 10,000 tonnes had caused the impact that they did, you can only imagine what 100,000 tonnes is going to do. And yet there's not really a clear indication, despite all this time, when a solution will be in place. I believe we need a clear timetable for emergency measures and also a clear timetable for the medium and long-term solutions and whether the finance will be available to carry out this work. So hence the petitioner's call for a public inquiry. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Rhoda Grant. I remember previously with this committee standing on a site investigation. You're absolutely right. I mean, the military road sits absolutely in the shadow of the principal route, and it's hardly a wonderful alternative, but at least was an alternative, but not in that very significant landslide. And the route on the valley opposite, I think was regarded as just being far too steep for to be developed in any sense for HGV or larger vehicles. So it's been a very significant ongoing problem. I come to members of the committee in the first instance, to Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to initially pay tribute to the MSPs who have in the past and also presently working on this, because it is an enormous issue for the local area, and they have really worked tirelessly. And as you've indicated, Convener, this committee in the past has visited the site and has seen firsthand. And I am well aware of, having been a member of the Parliament for the last session, how many times this was discussed, either in the chamber or through questions or just progressing through the situation. So I am looking at the objectivity of the where we are here, and I'm not sure where we can go as a committee. A public inquiry, I think, would exacerbate the situation in some ways. It would take length, it would take time. There's a huge amount of frustration already being sought and in the community, and they want a solution to this. I think that we've already heard that there's proposals coming forward that might well cover that. It may not please everybody, but at this stage, I really don't know what else can be done to try and facilitate and ensure, because I think that everybody from Transport Scotland, from the local members, have worked tirelessly. The council have all tried to participate. You know, 600 people gave feedback at the last. So there's a big involvement from the community itself, and I believe that they want a solution. But can a solution be found by going through a public inquiry? I would suggest that might not be the most effective way of supporting that. So I have some real concerns about how we take this forward, Convener, and it would be useful to hear others and other members have on their opinions on this as well.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Like my colleague, I have real doubts if we could take this petition forward, because I don't think one, the government would agree to it. But if you look at the past Public Petitions Committee, we have taken evidence for over 6 years on this. That's both you and I were on site visits there and seen how difficult the environment and the terrain was. So there's never an easy fix for this, and Transport Scotland has been working tirelessly with the local community and engaging with the local community to try and find solutions for this, because it is a real difficult task to try and make that hill stable without it continuing to have landslides in the area. And they've actually put measures in place to try and catch a lot of the debris coming down. And as you say, the old military road is there as an alternative, but they're trying to find solutions here, working with the community. As I said before, we have taken evidence over 6 years on this, and I think there is no place for this petition to go, and I'm quite happy to close it under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Turner. Thank you, Mr. Stewart. It's very difficult. I mean, I understand the motivations underpinning those who have brought the petition forward, because I sense that they have very much looked to the Public Petitions Committee, Citizen Engagement Public Petitions Committee, to keep the issue alive in the mind of Parliament, notwithstanding the intractable issues that sit around it. The Scottish Government did indicate that there would be a substantially 83 project update in early course. I hear your recommendation, Mr. Turns. I wonder if it would at least be appropriate to seek to find out when that might be, and let's find what is said in relation to that. Keep the petition open meanwhile. I think what I would say and what I would support is I don't see that we can have this petition run for a further 6 years in the way that the previous one did, because I'm not sure what we would achieve. But we are in a new parliament, and I think it would be useful for us at least to see what the further position is and whether there is any further light we can shed on things. But I think we do so very much sympathise with Mr. Stewart's view that, I mean, a public inquiry may not ultimately be the a suitable way forward. And the suggestion of a public inquiry is really the principal difference between this and, I think, David Torrance is suggesting, the previous petition, in which the committee heard extensive evidence over a number of years. So I'm minded, notwithstanding Mr. Torrance's recommendation, to hold it open for the moment to clarify when that strategic update is going to come from Transport Scotland, and to at least hear what that's got to say. But to give an indication to the petitioners who might be watching that I don't know that the committee is altogether persuaded by the public inquiry route on the basis of the submissions we've heard and the engagement that I think we can see already in place. Would that meet with the support of the committee? Yes, I think it would. Fine, thank you. Before I close, sorry, can I come back to you, Mr. Sweeney? Sorry, in relation to an earlier petition we considered, which was the funding for council venues. The clerks weren't just entirely clear when you said you wanted one of our stakeholders to be contacted on the record in relation to the points you were making, which stakeholder that was, if you were able just to confirm who it was you wanted us specifically to contact with the concerns that you highlighted.
I think it was referring to the 32 council leaders who have written en masse to the Scottish Government in recent weeks to express their concern about the latest budget round. So I think understanding their collective position as it currently stands would be helpful in that regard.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you again, Rhoda Grant, for joining us this morning and for your contribution to that petition, which, as you've heard, we will keep open for the time being and look to see what response we can get, because I do understand the very considerable issues, and I think you highlighted the very considerable costs as well that have been associated with simply trying to make do in relation to the existing facility. And with that, can I thank everybody for their forbearance with the remote format that we've been operating under this morning, for your contribution, and look forward to a future meeting. Having said that, David Torrance, I gather you'd like just to contribute further to the point we're just discussing.
It was just on the last petition, convener. I was quite happy to agree with you to write to the Scottish Government to seek clarification on when a new update of the project. But the petition actually calls for a request of public inquiry into the management of the Rest and Be Thankful project. Can we also write to the Scottish Government and say, will you go ahead with this inquiry? Because we will get a definitive answer for what the petition is calling on then.
Yeah, I'm quite happy that we do that. I think, as Mr. Stewart has suggested, I think that it is unlikely. That is my expectation. And for the reasons I think Mr. Stewart articulated, that the public inquiry itself might prolong and exacerbate the more detailed discussion required. But yes, I think we can do that too. But none of this diminishes from the importance of trying to seek to find a solution, or not to find it, but actually to progress it, because, you know, we've been wrestling with this for a very, very long time. That then again allows me to thank everybody for their contribution this morning and to close this meeting of the committee. Thank you.